The Winter Dance Party. Many people refer to the plane crash that took Buddy Holly's life as the day the music died. My name is Dion. I survived. I believe from my heart and to my very soul, that was the day the music exploded. There's a Bible verse that says, unless a seed falls to the ground and dies, it does not bear fruit. I know Buddy Holly was the model for the Beatles, the Stones, Jimi Hendrix, the rock band, rock and roll. We're here to talk about the Winter Dance Party Tour, the fatal plane crash that took Buddy Holly's life. There's been movies made about it. There's been stage plays done, countless magazine articles and reviews about it, and movies, books written, articles published, internet stories, and sometimes reading them, I think, why haven't they called me? I was there. I think at this time, if everybody who said they flipped a coin with Buddy Holly was supposed to be on that plane, they'd need a 747. So we're here to talk about that tour. There was a book written called The Day the Music Died. There was a song written called The Day the Music Died. And a lot of people define that day with those words. But I never let that song or that book define it for me. That was the day the music was born, in a sense. That was the day the music truly started. That was the day rock and roll was born. The band. My name is Dion. I consider myself a Bronx blues rocker, you know. Black music filtered through a Bronx neighborhood comes out with an attitude. I knew about, by the age of 16, I knew about 40 to 50 Hank Williams songs, and I was a tremendous Jimmy Reed fan. Used to go down to the Apollo and check him out. Love Jimmy Reed. Used to work the clubs when I was a kid in the Bronx, and well, I say clubs, but church dances. I started a doo-wop group called Dion and the Belmonts, early 1957. Had a big hit record the beginning of 1957. With a song called I Wonder Why. We used to go down to the Apollo Theater and listen to the great horn players like King Curtis and Big Al Sears and Ray Prysock. And, you know, they'd come out. I'd run back to the neighborhood. I'd say to get three guys, say, do this. So we did a song called I Wonder Why. I go dun 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 became a big hit. It was like number one in the Bronx and top 10 all over the country. And our first little tour was the Howard Theater in Washington, the Uptown Theater in Philly, then we went to the Apollo. Early that year, 1958, I went out on tour with Bobby Darin. 6 weeks, he had Splish Splash, and I loved being with Bobby Darin. He taught me how to pay taxes. My father never had a job, never made enough money to pay taxes. I didn't know what they were. So it was a novelty to me. I got a little journal at the corner drugstore, and I started putting down when I bought this, it was a novelty, and I ended up paying less taxes than the guys I was paying. And I knew there was something to it. In October, went out on tour with Buddy Holly. Now, I met Buddy Holly in New York because of the Alan Freed shows, the Fox shows, the Paramount shows, and meeting guys like the Everly Brothers. And I introduced all these guys to Phil's Men's Store on 3rd Avenue. Had all the cool sweaters. You know, it was the teen idol thing. And Buddy Holly went and got glasses. I don't know where he got those, but we were trying to spiff ourselves up, you know. He bought a tan caddy, got married to a girl in August 15th, 1958. Met this girl that was came from Puerto Rico, was living in New York, running a publishing company. or part of running a publishing company. In those days, I introduced him to Manny's Music Store. You know, he was wondering where the music stores were. I was up on New York. In fact, I introduced him to egg creams, pizza, Parmesan cheese. Later on, when I was on the Winter Dance Party tour with him, which I'm about to talk about, he leaned over to me one day and said, "Dion, you know, I'm going to tell you what kind of redneck I am. I thought Italian smelt bad." I said, "Smelt bad?" He said, I'm from Lubbock. I never smelt Parmesan cheese in my life." He said, I didn't know what it was. Marie Elena and he, they got an apartment down near Gramercy Park in the Village. Kind of cool. In 58. And Buddy started taking flying lessons out at Teterboro Airport in Jersey. And I'm just trying to give you the kind of layout of what was happening in the fall of 58. My wife, Susan, she was my girl at the time. She was hanging out with Jackie DeShannon and Sharon Sheely, Eddie Cochran's girlfriend. They would go to the Brasserie. I think the Brasserie still exists. It's on 53rd Street between Lex and Park. And back then, I was trying to introduce Buddy Holly to, I would ask him to go to the Harwin Club with me. There was a club that Bobby Darin and I used to go to and just, you know, jam all night. He played drums. Bobby Darin was multi-talented. He played piano. But I get up there and rock all night with the guitar. You know, I did this tour with Buddy Holly the first 3 weeks of October of 1958. And we got close. Marie Elena was following us. It was cold. We even went, some of the dates were up through Canada. And she was following us in this new tan caddy that Buddy bought. And she had a driver. He'd ride the bus or the car. And we got very close. And after that tour, just to document it, I did the little theater, the Dick Clark Saturday Night Show. I was doing a lot of those, but I did the Lowy State Theater in Manhattan with Chuck Berry, Eddie Cochran. And at that time, Buddy Holly did the little theater. It was a Saturday night show that Dick Clark did in the theater in Times Square. Now, in this period of time, December, I would say, of 58, Buddy started really getting into a riff with Norman Petty, who lived in Clovis. Buddy lived in Lubbock. Now, Clovis was, like, if you're looking at Texas, Lubbock's here, and Clovis is about 100 miles northwest. It's right over the line in New Mexico. And that's where he would record with the Crickets. And Norman Petty was his producer and wasn't letting his money go. He needed some cash, the apartment. He was doing big things in New York. The guy was a visionary. And he wanted to set up shop in New York. In fact, he wanted to start a label called Taupe. That was the color of the caddy. I called it tan. He called it taupe. Marie Elena was pregnant with Buddy's child. And she knew what was going on business-wise. I guess she was looking at his statements. And she asked a few questions, and Buddy wanted to get some money from Norman Petty, and Norman Petty told him all his money was tied up in some church funds. And a rift started. They were trying to hold on to him, and like I said, he wanted to set up shop in New York. He was close to his record company. He needed some cash and didn't have it, so he went to, at the time, I had an office right next to Paul Anka. We were like right across the hall. He was set up with his dad. His dad was an accountant, Paul Anka's dad. And Irving Feld was his manager. So Irving Feld, over at GAC, started putting this tour together. to start in January of 59, called the Winter Dance Party Tour. And Buddy talked to me about it. That's how, you know, eventually I went out with the tour. He needed cash. And he was kind of brokenhearted. The Crickets were like siding with Norman Petty and didn't want to come up to New York. And he went down there to try to repair things and couldn't. They started putting the tour together. Ritchie Valens from the San Fernando Valley, Chicano from the Barrio, a voice like an angel, a quiet kid. He looked like Rocky Marciano, but he was very sweet. And the Bopper, the Big Bopper, J.P. Richardson from Texas. So that's the poster. We went out on tour together in late January. So the headliners of the Winter Dance Party Tour, Buddy Holly and the Crickets, the Big Bopper, Ritchie Valens, Dion and the Belmonts. The Bopper was a great guy. He had like the ministry of face. You know, he was like a fun-loving, dart-throwing, beer-drinking. I called him Bulbs. He used to get on the bus. He was like, he brought his own environment. He'd light up the bus. Hey, Bulbs, you know. very cool guy. Dion and the Belmonts, we were like rappers from the Bronx. We were like gang members. Two of the guys, well, there were three Belmonts, but one of them had a commitment to the Navy, Angelo, who didn't come out on the tour. He took off to the Navy. Angelo DeLeo had a voice like, God knows, like Geely. He had perfect pitch and great to sing with, and a great guy. And he's my hero, always will be my hero. Carlo Mastrangelo, a jazz drummer from the Bronx. I was so proud to work with this guy. I used to look at him in awe. But who knew? He never practiced and nothing, but he could get on drums and kick you through the roof. And Freddie Milano, the other Belmont I recruited, was great with harmonies. We were to all meet in Chicago to rehearse January 22nd. I flew there. I don't know, I think some of the guys in my group had taken a train and bus. I think Buddy drove, I'm not sure. We get there January 22nd on a Thursday. We rehearse all day. It seems to me that Buddy has a pickup band. Where are the Crickets? I don't know. Jerry Allison, Joe B, Sonny Curtis, no one was there but some new guys who I'll talk about later. We rehearsed that day. Everything went pretty well. January 23rd, we all get on this, looked like a little yellow church school bus to me, and we're on our way to Milwaukee, less than 100 miles up the road, I think. And we all get on the bus, make our way up to Milwaukee, and we check in, and we appear at the George Devine's Million Dollar Ballroom in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. We also have some new guys on the bus. They augment the three guys that Buddy brought with him. There was a trumpet player, a horn player, and a sax player. The sax player I got is, I think his name was Tom Mason or something. Back in the day, we didn't have time to shred guitar solos. Records were 2.5 minutes. If you listen to any Buddy Holly records, there's no guitar solos on them. But in person, we were honing our skills. We'd be like, we were in a contest. Ritchie Valens, Buddy Holly, and myself, we had these new Fender Stratocasters. And we were in a contest to see who would make it ring the longest. And we were honing our skills as guitar players. You know, Buddy would be, you know. All of my love, all of my kissing. You don't know what you've been missing. Oh boy, when you're with me, oh boy. The world see will add you. One man for me. Yeah, I'll never, you know. know, and I'd be like, hey, little girl, well, don't you understand? I want to be your love man all by myself. All by myself. I don't need nobody to love me. I want to love you all by myself. And Ritchie would be like, you know, again and again, yeah. You know, we would try anything. We were like, yo, the kid is here, you know. And I forget who won the contest, but we were having a great time. We were crisscrossing the upper Midwest, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Iowa, and it was cold. The tour was to last for 25 days, 25 shows in a row. A dollar in advance, a dollar and a quarter at the door. We're driving down a road, crisscrossing the upper Midwest, tree branches a snapping in the wind. I mean, it was freezing. In fact, it was so cold, I wrote this song on the bus. We used to all sing it. Tearing down the highway, look at all that ice and snow. Yeah, I'm getting ready, baby, I'm another show. I'm gonna hug my radiator when I hit my hotel room. Oh, Chicago, Fargo, another town they call Green Bay. You know my bones are rocking crazy, mama shaking, baby, all the way. I'm gonna hug my radiator when I hit my hotel room. Ah, nothing really matters when you're riding on a broken down bus. All I got is you, all you got is me. Add it up and we got. I'm a fast dancing, romancing, blue jean rocker, you see. Baby, I'm feeling colder than an icicle hanging on a tree. I'm gonna hug my radiator when I hit my hotel room. Everybody, hug my radiator. Hug my radiator. Hug my radiator.
Hug my radiator.
Come on, yeah. Hug my radiator.
Hug my radiator.
You don't even know what a radiator is, right? Hug my radiator when I hit my hotel room. Something like that. Ritchie Valens was freezing. I got to tell you, Ritchie came from the barrio in the San Fernando Valley. He never saw weather so cold. Buddy come from Lubbock, Texas. I'm sure it was cold there, but not like this. Same with J.P. Richardson, the Big Bopper. Now me, I come from Bronx, New York City. I kind of was in some tough winter weather, you know. I had a sled when I was a kid, okay? We were poor. My father and mom would get the bacon grease or any kind of grease that came from the skillet. Put it in a coffee pan, and when winter came around, they'd take that lard and put it in the seams of your shoes to keep the water out, you know, that sealed your shoes. That's what I did on that tour. I got myself some butter. I put it in my shoes. I was like rocking. I was home, all right, but it was cold, and we're crisscrossing the Midwest up there, and it's like some of the jumps were, you know, 360 miles, some were 400. I mean, and we're jamming in the back of the bus. We're telling stories. We're sharing songs. And me, Buddy Holly was amazed, and his band was amazed at some of the songs I came up with, because I knew about 40 to 50 Hank Williams songs. I'd come up with songs they never heard Hank Williams sing. But he wrote and sang, but I knew him. Oh, you know that I've come back, we've tried it all. But each time, my dear, it was worse than before. But now my heart's sick, it's sad and it's sore. Never again will I knock on your door. I would do his whole Luke the Drifter series, kind of like in the world's mighty gallery of pictures, hang the scenes that are painted from life, the hang scenes of love and a passion, pictures of peace and of strife, the hang pictures of you been a beauty, of old age and the blushing young bride. They'd all hang on the wall, but the saddest of all, the pictures from life's other side. The pictures from life's other side. Someone was spilled by the way. Life has gone out with a tide. Might have been happy someday. There's a pearl mother at home, watching and waiting along. She's just longing to hear from a loved one so dear. Just a picture from life's other side. The Midwest was so cold, jumping from one town to the next on this little yellow school bus. The heater wasn't all that good. It was not a luxury, customized Golden Eagle bus. It was just a school bus. And we'd sleep in the luggage racks, and the luggage racks had those, I don't know, they soldered the sheet metal, and they'd dig in your sides, and we'd try to do everything we could to sleep. One night it was so cold, Buddy and I threw a blanket over our heads, and we were telling stories to each other. So, I mean, he's from Lubbock, Texas, I'm from the Bronx, and I'm telling him that there's guys in my neighborhood, Frankie Yunk Yunk, Joe Beebe Eyes, Ralphie Moach. I told him, you know, everybody had nicknames. There was a guy named Shakespeare in my neighborhood. He used to say, to be or not to be, which is my apartment. And Buddy never got that because I don't think they had tenement buildings in Lubbock at the time. And, you know, and he would tell me some stories about Billy Joe and Bobby Jean, you know. And, of course, we'd share stories about the Apollo Theater because we both played the Apollo. And how we won the audience over. Baby's head. Oh, bright lights, a big sedan, gone to my baby's head. I try to learn a woman, but nobody even word they said. And, you know, and he would talk about his thing and how great the Apollo was and I remember one time he showed me some blueprints of a studio and a house he was building in Lubbock. He was becoming a pilot because his brothers, he came from Texas, they flew. Maria Elena was pregnant. He was having a child. They were married 6 months at the time. He talked about going to England. Hopefully to get back with the Crickets. But on that tour, he would get a lot of phone calls. You know, in the back they had pay phones, and we didn't have cell phones or email or anything. But they had pay phones in the back of the these ballrooms or armories that we'd play. And he'd get calls from the Crickets, and they were kind of perturbed that he was using the name The Crickets, and they weren't there. And There was some problems, but he was a very fun-loving guy. He loved his father. His father was a hard-working guy. Loved his mom, his brothers, and loved being a Texan. He'd talk about Samuel Houston. He'd talk about the treaty that Texas signed, that they could pull out of the Union anytime they want. They could pull out of the states anytime they wanted. He was like, a Texan, like proud people. I never really seen him get, he wasn't an angry guy. He wasn't a resentful guy. He was a very classy guy. Buddy was a visionary, very interesting guy. On one hand, you had this free abandon. He'd walk out on stage, take the stance, hit a chord, and hold on to your ass. Man, we're going somewhere. I'm taking you on a trip. On the other hand, he was very structured and formal, deliberate, very decisive. The guy was an old soul. He was a great businessman and fearless. He was fearless. He chartered a plane. Could you find me a 22-year-old today that has kind of qualities like that? You know, the guy was an interesting mix, you know. Buddy Holly, he also carried a gun. He had a little 22 pistol. I said, you know, and to me, I was from the Bronx. I was 19, he was 22. Now, anybody who carries a gun in my neighborhood, they're a cop or they're a gangster. I don't know who carries a gun. But in Texas, they had them mounted in the back of their trucks, you know. So he carried this gun. Freddie Milano, one of the guys in the Belmonts, was totally in awe of this guy and his gun. Buddy Holly was his own security. I said, Buddy, why do you have a gun? He says, I carry a lot of money at times, Dion. He says, I got to protect myself. So we're crisscrossing the upper Midwest. Great times, great shows. We're rocking out, having a good old time. I believe Dylan said he showed up in St. Paul or Duluth one day, but I know on one of the jumps, we did a show in St. Paul and we were going down to Davenport, Iowa. And it was a long, long drive. We get there like, we do a show, great. We're having a great time. We're starting to really enjoy each other's sets. And we get some sleep that night. This is where the trouble started. some of the deep trouble. We get up, we leave Davenport about 10 in the morning, and we're on our way to Fort Dodge, Iowa. And it is a drive. We start out, and the bus breaks down, the heater breaks down, and it is freezing. And like I said, some of these guys never experienced weather like that. Me, I was on a field trip. I had my homeboys with me. We're drinking some of this, some of that. We were warm, we're happy, we're laughing. We break down in a place called Tipton, Iowa. I remember Tipton because the Belmonts and I used to have this game. We used to read things backwards. You know, like our names were, like Carlo was Allrack, Angelo was Olegna, Freddie was Durf, I was Noid. You know, if we were eating, you know, like Frankfurter, Retroff Knarf. You know, we'd read things backwards. So I remember Tipton because it was not Pitt. And we broke down in Tipton and pulled into a garage and to fix the heater. Everybody jumps off the bus. Who runs to the Army and Navy store to buy some pants and gloves and more socks? And who runs over to the diner to get something to eat? Buddy and I went over to the Edsel dealership. We're looking at Edsels. Freddie goes over to the gun shop and buys a Luger with a shoulder holster. He gets back on the bus. We're on our way to Fort Dodge. He's enthralled with his Luger. He's got a pint of Jack Daniels, and he's got his Luger. And he's waving it around the bus. We had a black driver. The black driver said, "Hey, son, don't point that gun at me or take the clip out of that gun, you know?" He was like, because Freddie was waving it around, pointing it at the driver, you know, talking about, when I get home, I'm going to get respect, you know, and this whole thing. He's going through this whole thing. Well, we get to Fort Dodge. We're fine. We do a show. We got to get to Duluth, Minnesota the next night, which is like almost 400 miles, maybe 360, 380, I don't know. January 31st, Saturday night in Duluth, incredible show. We had a great finale, huge crowd. We're enjoying. We're getting the solos together. We're starting to really seep into the thing, you know. It's kind of cool. Early in the morning, 1:30, Sunday, we get on the bus. We're going to go to Appleton, Wisconsin, and Green Bay. We have a matinee in Appleton at 1:30, and we have a show in Green Bay, which is right above it, you know, stone's throw. So we start out on Route 2, coming down to hit 51. We make a turn at Ironwood. We're on our way down to Appleton, and the bus breaks down early Sunday morning. Who's open early Sunday morning, 4 o'clock in the morning? We're in the middle of this, who knows what? We don't know where we are. It's just blinding snow. And the bus breaks down. The piston rod went right through the engine. Dead on the side of the road. Now, I think we were down near Pine Lake somewhere, but there's nothing there. So we start getting off the bus and flagging down cars that are coming not very often. But the first guy who shows up says, "Listen, there's nothing south. Don't continue south down to Appleton. Go back to Ironwood and Hurley. You know, go back there. There's garages there. It's closer, and there's more happening up there. You'll maybe get somebody to come down with an engine." I don't know what the deal was. But we get out and we start waving down buses. Now, I didn't sense any danger. I was on a field trip. We broke down. Ha ha! Give me a sip of the, you know. Freddie's in the middle of the aisle with his Johnny Walker and his gun. You want a shot or you want to get shot? You know. And he's like, you know, he's doing his thing, and guys are sleeping, and some guys were so cold they wanted to, you know, burn newspaper in the aisles of the bus. Now, the trumpet player, who we didn't know, I used to call him Squiggy. I didn't want to call him Squeaky, but he was like, whining. You know, like, to me, whining is pushing a resentment through a small hole. It's like, yeah. He was always like, yeah. So he's like in the middle of this thing. He says, "You don't understand." He gets up. 4 in the morning, black, total darkness, snow's coming down. He says, "You don't understand. We're going to be dead in 2 hours. We're going to be dead. You don't understand. People die on these roads all the time. We're going to be dead in 2 hours. Freddie takes the Luger out and he points it at him. He says, "Hey, you're going to be dead in 2 or 3 seconds if you don't shut the fuck up." You know, this guy had to he was like wheeling the gun around. So we're getting rides to Ironwood. Carl Bunch, the drummer on the tour, he put on 5 pair of socks on each foot. He gets frostbite. He was so cold. And a lot of the armories we were working were like skating rinks. So our feet were always cold. And he thought he was going to put all these socks on and be warm. But what he did was held the cold in. He got frostbite. His toes started turning blue. So we put him in one of the first cars, got him up to Ironwood and shipped him over to right down the street to Hurley. There was a hospital there, and we left him there. And by the time all of us caught rides to Ironwood, morning came and there was a train to Green Bay. So the Goose goes to the hospital, Carl Bunch. We have no drummer. Carlo is one of the greatest drummers you ever want to hear, a natural. Kicked the Maynard Ferguson band through the roof when we played the Apollo Theater. He gets on drums and backs up most of the tour. And when it came to our show, Buddy Holly played drums behind us. I think I'm probably the only rock and roller who could say Buddy Holly played drums for me. I mean, that was a kick. But when Carlo played drums for Buddy, he tuned the drums to A, D, and E for Peggy Sue, you know. Buddy went out of his mind. He never heard an attitude like that behind Peggy Sue. Carlo kicked that song. It was stirring. After the show, Buddy comes to me and he said, "How much do you pay that guy?" He said, "Dion, I'm willing to pay him twice as much, three times as much as you pay him." I said to him, "Buddy, if you give him your salary, it won't work. Because Carlo does not fly, and he's difficult to work with. He's difficult." Canceled the show in Appleton. We had a great time in Green Bay, great show. We had a long drive because we had to go over to Clear Lake, Iowa. Buddy starts talking about flying. He's like, "Dion, got to charter a plane. We could split it." The headline is, "We're the guys who are making the money. We should charter a plane." Charter a plane in Clear Lake, go over to Moorhead, and we could get our laundry done, get a nice meal, take a shower, get a good night's sleep. I'm gonna see what I could do. So we're traveling, we get to Clear Lake. We broke down again, I think a belt on the belts in the bus. We get over to Clear Lake, Iowa. We arrived there pretty late. Buddy seeks out the promoter of the ballroom, Carol Anderson, in his office. He's talking to him about a plane. Meanwhile, the tour's got to get ready for an 8 o'clock show. Everybody starts getting ready. People are on the phone, backstage. You know, every time we hit a new place, we hit the payphone, everybody'd get online. I got to tell you this one thing, though. The night before, Ritchie Valens, who was so cold, so sick, and kind of looked forlorn, you know. He was a sweet guy. And I remember, you know, he's talking to his mom backstage, you know, on the payphone. "Mom, I'm cold, I'm this, I miss you guys." And his mom, he had talked to her a few times. She's telling, and you know, gets me on the phone one of the nights saying, "Dion, take care of my little boy." He was no little boy. He looked like Rocky Marciano. But I mean, he wasn't a tough guy, but he was no little boy. She's saying, "Take care of him." He was only 17. And I remember maybe in Duluth, he got a cardboard box with a clothesline, wrapped in clothesline. And it was like it looked like a pea coat, but it wasn't a pea coat. Looked like a pea coat with sparkles on it, you know. And his mom sent him a coat because even in Tipton, he wouldn't buy anything. I don't know. I guess he was used to his mom buying his clothes. I'm not sure. But she sent him a coat. And anyway, when we're in Clear Lake, we're all on the phone. And, you know, Jerry Allison wants to talk to Buddy. He's kind of angry that he's using the Crickets name. And what, you know, JP's talking to his family, and every time Buddy's talking to Maria Elena, I don't know, there's been all kinds of stories. All I know is when I'm listening to those guys, he's like, Maria, I adore you, I love you, I miss you, all that kind of stuff. He was kind of a model for me. We got to the Surf Ballroom very late. It was like 5, 6 o'clock, and we had an 8 o'clock show. We jump out of the bus, everybody's getting ready, shaving, you know, getting ready for an 8 o'clock show. Buddy seeks out the promoter, Carol Anderson, looking to charter a plane. Carol Anderson calls up Jwaya Air Service, the airfield, the service there in Mason City. I think he gets in touch with a pilot who gets in touch with Jerry Dwyer, who owns the place, and Buddy rents a plane. But meanwhile, we're all getting ready. And the way the show went was Frankie Sardo, the Big Bopper, got on, hello, baby. Yeah, and now Big Bopper wrote White Lightning for George Jones. I mean, come on. He was like, and I said, he brought the atmosphere with him. He was like the Ministry of Face. He had a smile, the guy would light up the room. He goes on. Dion and the Belmonts follow the JP, Ritchie Valens, then Buddy, then a finale, everybody gets on. Now, we didn't only do our songs. I mean, for myself, we were doing like Great Balls of Fire. We were doing a lot of Fats Domino songs. Like I told you, we'd open up with, hey little girl, but don't you understand? I wanna be your loving man. All by myself, all by myself. I don't need nobody to love you, gonna love you all by myself. You know, that kind of stuff. Anyway, we're going crazy. We're rocking out. 1,500 people there. We're having a great time. It was a great show. But what happened, the other events that took place, is when Frankie Sardo got out there with the band, Buddy called me over, said, hey, get JP, call Ritchie. We went into a room, a vacant dressing room. He shut the door. He was kind of a classy guy. I didn't want to offend anybody. He said, hey, listen, I chartered a plane. We're the guys making the money. The only problem is there's two seats, so only two of you could go. Want to work it out, flip a coin. We flipped. JP pulls heads. He says, listen, heads, you go. Tails, you're riding the golden chariot. I pull heads, Ritchie gets tails. When he told me $36 to get on that plane to split the cost, that was like a magic number for me. My parents always argued about the $36 a month rent in Bronx, New York City. Now, that, just to give you some idea, it's 2009 right now. That was 1959. The plane they were taking, the Beechcraft Bonanza, was worth, you could buy one back then for like $20,000. Today, it would cost you $800,000. So, I just want to show you that $36 was a lot of money. It was over $400. My head hadn't stretched out to spend that kind of money on a flight from Clear Lake, Iowa to Fargo, North Dakota. It was what we were told. It was like 400 miles. The flight was going to be less than 2 hours. Get our laundry done. Get some sleep. Get a meal. Take a shower. You know, get some rest. So I win the toss, one of the guys winning the toss, but the $36 was the deciding factor for me. I said, Ritchie, he was so cold, sick, and lonely looking, and he was alone. I had my homeboys, the Belmonts, with me. I said, Ritchie, you take this, you take it, you go. And he said, thanks. When we walked out of that dressing room, we knew who was going to be on that flight. After the show, great finale. We had a ball. We rocked. We did solos. You know, we the place was jammed, 1,500 people. Very happy with the whole thing. These guys, we're packing up, getting on the bus. Carol Anderson pulls up in a station wagon. Ritchie says to me, I hope this plane has a better heater than the bus. I said, Ritchie, take your coat, you know. And Buddy says to me, Dion, take care of my guitar. Dion, take care of my guitar like you take care of your testicles. So I looked at him, I never heard any, you know, I'm thinking, yeah, I get it. So years later, when Pete Townsend started breaking his guitars on stage, I went like, ooh, you know, like, what the hell? I didn't know what was going on. We had these new Stratocasters that we cherished. So to me, that was like sacrilege, you know. Didn't get it. So they take off for the airport. We load the bus up. We left Clear Lake, Iowa, very late. We got on the bus, started moving, started heading towards Moorhead, Minnesota, 400 miles. We're gonna drive all night. From what I understand, the guys got on that plane 12:30, 1 o'clock in the morning to fly to Fargo, which was right over the Red River, 5 minutes from Moorhead. The next morning, we had some bus trouble. We had some bus trouble on the way, but the next morning when we arrived, it almost seemed like summer to me. It was like 10:30 in the morning. The sun was shining. I remember it kind of warm. I get off the bus. I know Sam Geller was the tour manager of the winter dance party. I got very close with Sam Geller. He was a real nice guy. Walks into the lobby. Now I'm thinking back. He must have walked up to the desk and said, you know, something. It probably said they didn't arrive. They died in the plane last night, because the locals were watching this TV in the lobby. They were this black and white TV, and it said, rock and roll stars die in plane crash. Buddy Holly, the Big Bopper, Ritchie Valens. And I'm looking at Sam, he's looking at me, I'm dumbfounded. I don't know what to make of it. I'm like in shock. And he comes over to me and he says, they didn't make it. I said, what do you mean, Sam? He says, the plane crashed. And I start walking out, the guys start coming in, and I'm walking out. I walk out to the bus, I'm kind of in a daze. I get on the bus, and it seemed like I was alone on the bus. I'm sitting there with Buddy Holly's guitar, Ritchie Valens, his outfit, you know, his little vest hanging up, and the Big Bopper's hat is in the luggage rack, and I'm thinking, what the hell is going on? I mean, I was like baffled. I was in a trance. I can't even explain what happened to me. It was like the rug was ripped out from under me. I was just, you know, having a ball, jamming in the back of the bus with these guys for like a week, and I didn't get, you know, can't even explain it. Anyway, we check into the Comstock Hotel in Moorhead. I remember that day that we all got together in a room. Sam got us together in a room. We decided to go on with the tour. We thought that's what the guys would want us to do. Don't ask me how. I'm thinking, you know, first of all, their songs are part of my DNA. They're part of my, they're in my bones. I could sing any one of the songs. I've heard them so many times, you know. So I'm thinking, well, I'll do Donna, or I'll do, you know, I don't know what I was thinking. But I got to get down to the lobby and call my mom. So I get down to the lobby, you know, and all the phones are taken. Everybody's trying to, you know, get to their call, their parents or their loved ones. I got my mom, but And thank God I got her before she heard anything. Because back then, you got to understand, everybody listened to radio, top 40 radio. That was more than watching TV or reading. They listened to radio. They had the radio on all the time. And my father was working in a church basement and heard the news that three rock and rollers died in a plane crash. He told me later on it was like he was getting heart, open heart surgery without the anesthesia. And my sister Joni said she was over a friend's house making a sandwich, and they both fell to their knees. She just felt crushed. She heard it on the radio. But I got my mom in time, thank God. And you know, Buddy, the Big Bopper, JP, and Ritchie, no one called their houses. So I think their parents and most of their families heard it by radio. So, and who thought at that time? That's what happened. That night in Moorhead, we decided to go on with the show and on with the tour. We had 2 weeks left. The tour was supposed to end February 15th. It was February 3rd. From what I understand, Charlie Boone, who had a radio show, a DJ, put out an SOS, an appeal to the community. He said, you know, if there's a band in town that could help out. I don't know if they ran a contest or what, but Bobby V showed up with his brother. And they were on the show. They filled in. He did a few songs. And we've been fast friends. We've been friends ever since. Dear man. It was a good evening. I got up. I remember doing, you know, some of Buddy's songs. I might have did That'll Be the Day and, you know, Rave On. Must have got up and said something. I know I talked, and I said I lost my three dear friends today in a plane crash. They were great songwriters and great guys and great guitar players and great singers, but most of all, they felt like brothers to me, part of my family, part of our troupe. I'm going to miss them terribly. I'm going to remember them forever. I'll never forget them, you know. And in true rock and roll fashion, rave on forever. Well, baby, now the little things that you say and do make me feel wanna be with you. Rave on, it's a crazy feeling, and I know it's a guns of feeling when you say I love you. Rave on. Well, the way you dance, you know. Come on, you know, those songs like that. Like I said, they're in my DNA. And, you know, I remember the promoter that night. We had a great show. We got through it. We talked, we bonded, we helped each other. I started to know Waylon Jennings, who was the bass player. On that tour, I got a little closer to Carl Bunch. We called him Goose. He was the drummer, Tommy Alsup, the guitar player. I remember that night we all got on the bus and Sam Geller came out, got on the bus. He says, you know, the promoter wants to dock us $450. Now you got to understand, we were contracted. The whole show was contracted for a little over $600. The guy wanted a whole 3/4 of the money out because three guys didn't show up. Freddie with his Luger. We walk into the office. I don't want to tell you the guy's name, but we walk into the office. Freddie with his Luger. We made him an offer he couldn't refuse, and we got our money, and we were back on the bus. So the Luger came in handy, you know. We found out later on that Roger Peterson, who died in that plane crash, who was the pilot, wasn't certified to fly by instruments. He didn't know how to read the indicator. They had changed the indicator in the Beechcraft Bonanza. The indicator had a seesaw kind of thing. They changed it to a bubble. You have to know where the horizon is, otherwise, a little off, you drive the plane right into the ground. And I don't think it was any, you know, a lot of stories came out about Buddy Holly wanted to fly the plane. He was trying to take the controls over. They flew that plane. Roger Peterson flew that plane into the ground 4 minutes after they took off. He took off south, tried to make a turn to go northwest. It was over. There was a front coming in. Later on, it was found out that Roger Peterson was kind of, he got let go from a lot of places. He was kind of a troubled, and Jerry Dwyer, the owner of that flying service, took him on because he knew the family and he wanted to give the kid a break. He was 21 years old, Roger Peterson. But he wasn't certified to fly with a hood, to, you know, they call it scudding. Under the clouds you could go. You could go by reading the lights on the lampposts and the farmhouses. You could see, as long as you could see. But when the front came in, when that blizzard hit, it was cold when those guys got on the plane. And let me tell you, from what I understand, when a front comes in like that, even lights, if you get vertigo, they look like stars. You don't know which way you're going. And if you could just be going a little off of level, and you drive the plane right into the ground. And that's what happened. He got vertigo, plain and simple, and those guys didn't know what hit him. It was all over in 4 minutes. And I got to say that Buddy Holly, Ritchie Valens, the Bopper, they affected my life in a huge way, on many levels. I mean, they made me start asking questions of myself, like, who am I? Where am I going? What's this about? What's my purpose in life? And I got answers. You ask questions, you'll get answers. People who don't ask questions get stuck. I noticed that in these years. Now as we moved on to Sioux City, Iowa, the next night we got telegrams and cards from Eddie Cochran, from Bobby Darin, Phil Spector called, Dick Clark, with words of consolation and encouragement and love and support. And we went on with the tour, but it wasn't the same. It was not the same. I was in shock. I don't remember too much, but I know Frankie Avalon came aboard and finished up the tour with us, and I know Jimmy Clanton, but to be honest with you, I don't remember too much of it. I do remember Ronnie Smith, Waylon and Tommy Alsup, and they had gotten this kid to come up from Texas, who was great. He rocked. The only thing is, he was like Presley. You looked at him and you went, hey, it was like a Presley imitator. But he was good. And the last night, I know we played, I think it was Springfield, Illinois, and on the 15th of February, and I made it up the next day to Chicago to fly home. I was on this new plane. It was I remember it. So they told me it was a turbojet, an electrojet. It had turbo props. It was like half jet, half props. And Sammy Davis was on it. He was sat across the aisle from me. I thought, if it goes down, I'll die with Sammy Davis. You know? But what I'm saying is that I got back on the horse. I was, that's the way I wanted to do it. I just wanted to. A lot of the guys drove home, got on trains, took buses. But I flew home. Flew into LaGuardia Airport. My parents were happy to see me. Reporters all around the house. I didn't talk to anybody. I just didn't want to talk to anybody. Susan, my girl at the time, who took that picture. She's my wife today. We've been married 46 years. And I think it had a little to do with Buddy Holly and his modeling marriage to me. And I've stayed friends with Maria Elena, his wife, who's a terrific girl and a sharp businesswoman. You know, they didn't have grief counseling in the Bronx. So what did I do? I drank, I took a little of this drug, a little of that drug, you know, and I remember Buddy telling me, I thought back to some of the things he would say, and one thing I remembered, he used to say, Dion, I don't know how to succeed, but I know how to fail. Try to please everybody. And I think if it wasn't for him saying that, I don't know if I would have did Run Around Sue and The Wanderer and Ruby Baby, Donna the Prima Donna, or even Abraham, Martin, and John. So I tried to avoid the pain in so many ways, or the frustration or the confusion. I didn't know where to place it, what to do with it. I just, give me this kind of pill, let me smoke that, let me drink that. That's where I was at, you know. Buddy Holly was the first self-contained rock and roll group. Two guitars, bass, and drums. Two guitars, bass, and drums were popular 50 years ago, and they'll be popular 50 years from now. The guy influenced every English group you could think of, you know, and Americans don't get it sometimes, but Europeans get it. You know, this guy influenced so many artists. You know, personally, I think I did those guys proud. The music didn't die. It lives. I never put a lot of things to rest, but sometimes writing puts your heart in a little bit of peace, gives your heart a little bit of peace. And these songs that I write sometimes are the best way to get my emotions out and put things to rest. I do it with music.
What I do every day, I raise my fists for the struggle. Every day that I'm with you, every day I wake up hungry. Yeah, and I try to get my fill. Anyway, it's a great big country, and I've got time to kill. Warm summer night. Every day you call upon the angels. They do what you tell them to. I'm walking just a little south of heaven. Every day that I'm with you. Yeah. Every day that I'm with you. Every day you call upon. Tell them to. I'm walking just a little south of heaven. Every day that I'm with you. I've crossed mountains, I've crossed valleys, walked the highway sea to sea. Every day is another blind alley. Every day just you and me. The sun is always shining somewhere when you. heartbeats in time. Every day I get a little closer, yeah, and I get another clue. Every way I feel more and more and more every day that I'm with you. Every day that I'm with you. Every day that I'm with you.
Those guys dying that February night, I don't really know how it affected me. I don't know really where I put it. I didn't talk about it. Like I said, there's been movies made, articles written, plays done, books written. No one's ever talked to me about it. I don't know how willing I was to talk about it, to be honest with you. Don't know how I process it, but over the years, I've come to terms with it. I was talking to Maria Elena recently. She said, Dion, I never believed Buddy was dead. The last 50 years, she says, this year, it kind of solidifies it for me. She said, but I was so busy with the foundation and just busy with his memory and putting things in place for him that I really never, she never even, I don't think, went to his gravesite. Just kept him alive in her heart. I don't know how I processed it all. Maybe sitting right here and talking about it puts my heart to rest. And wherever you are, Buddy, and wherever you are, Ritchie, and JP, I hope to do you proud and still love you.
Every day I stare down trouble. Heaven knows that's what I do.